On June 18, 1178, several monks at an abbey in Canterbury, England, saw something very odd happen to the moon. The chronicler Gervais of Canterbury wrote that he and the other monks saw a flaming torch spring up from the moon's limb. He goes on to say that the phenomena repeated several times over a short period of time. Ancient and medieval accounts are vague by nature when it comes to a scientific phenomenon, no matter what culture they come from. But it could be said that this particular one might be something close to what a person might see if they watched the moon get struck by a crater-forming meteorite. In fact, we might have indications of which specific crater was formed. While the moon is covered with craters, it's been collecting them since volcanism ended there long ago, it's not often that someone actually observes the formation of one. In 1976, geologist Jack Hartung proposed that right about in the area where the monks saw their flaming torch coming from, there is a rather fresh-looking crater now, named after Giordano Bruno. Surrounding it is a prominent rayed pattern of material that could suggest that it's fresh enough to have been laid out in 1178 AD. People tend to think of the moon's surface as unchanging, but in reality the moon is subject to a constant rain of micrometeorites. Over time, these sort of harden the surface and erode things. Giordano Bruno's rays do not appear to be very eroded, and the idea of a sizable crater forming on the moon within recorded history suggests that Earth got lucky in 1178. We could just as easily have been hit by this object. While it's by no means impossible that a large meteorite would hit the moon and form a 22-kilometer crater within recorded human history, we'll no doubt see this happen again at some point, there's a problem with the 1178 event. It's thought that the creation of such a large crater on the moon would throw a lot of debris into space, and Earth would then be subject to spectacular meteor showers for some time afterwards. But those showers do not seem to have happened, or at least no one recorded them if they did. And this was at a time when astronomers across the globe were recording whatever oddness they saw in the skies. No one in Europe, Arabia, China, the New World, India, etc. seems to have seen anything. That opens up the possibility that the Canterbury monks merely happened to see a head-on meteorite entry that just happened to be within their line of sight of the moon. That also might explain why they seem to have been the only people on Earth who recorded the phenomenon. They were merely lined up just right. But this is one lunar mystery that someday we probably will have an answer for. Whenever we colonize the moon, no doubt geologists will study the Giordano Bruno crater up close and determine just when it formed. But all of this does relate to a group of papers that, if correct, could have broad implications on the future safety of our world. Some of these papers link Gervais of Canterbury's account with remnants of a large periodic comet that's been disintegrating for the last 20 or 30,000 years, perhaps brought on by too close of a pass to Earth. The biggest remaining fragment from this original comet is thought to be Comet Encke, a fairly low-key short-period comet that enters the inner solar system every 3.3 years. This comet and the disintegration process has created trails of debris that Earth periodically passes through. In fact, one such cloud left by Comet Encke is responsible for the main Taurid meteor shower in October and November of each year. The Taurids are unusual for meteor showers, which typically consist of sand-like grains of dust entering the atmosphere. The Taurids, however, produce occasional fireballs from pebble-sized material. Also, this meteor shower is not usually that great as far as meteor showers go. Typically, if you go out, you'll see 5 or so meteors per hour radiating from the constellation of Taurus. But occasionally, the Taurids can go crazy when Earth passes through denser areas of the meteor stream. This actually has a cycle. About every 3,000 years, we go through the core of the material and intense showers are seen. In fact, it's been suggested that the construction of Stonehenge might be linked to ancient people seeing such a shower, though I find that a pretty hard sell for something that was an evolving religious and burial site for centuries. But there are other cases of the main Taurids going crazy, and there are other meteor shower streams associated with this material. In 1975, seismometers placed on the lunar surface during the Apollo missions detected a swarm of small impacts hitting the moon. This swarm began pelting the lunar surface on June 22nd, and is associated with another section of the swarm which is responsible for the Beta Taurid and Zeta Perseid meteor showers, which we don't get to see much of due to them peaking while the daylight side of the planet passes through the swarm. But note that date, June 22nd, and note that Gervais of Canterbury's impact was on June 18th. On November 7, 2005, within the time frame of the main Taurid meteor shower, another impact on the moon was witnessed, though this one was smaller than whatever Gervais of Canterbury saw. NASA scientists Rob Suggs and Bill Cook observed a small impact on the moon, linked to the paper below. They concluded once again that it was probably part of the Taurid meteor stream. But just how big can these Taurid chunks be? No one really knows, but a theory put forth by Kenneth Brecher of Boston University in the 1980s, link in the description below, suggested that maybe Gervais of Canterbury's lunar impact might have been related to another subset swarm, called the Canterbury Swarm, of this cometary debris field. If true, this is a problem because if what those monks saw was the creation of an impact crater, and the Giordano Bruno crater is a result of that, then it was not a small object, and other such objects could pose a threat to Earth, as noted by Victor Club of Oxford in a 1992 paper, link in the description below. But remember June 18th and 22nd coinciding with the Beta Taurids? Well, it just so happens that on June 30th, 1908, the Tunguska event occurred, and astronomers Duncan Steele and Bill Napier have suggested that the Beta Taurids could have been responsible for it, link to their paper in the description below. Tunguska is a well-known event and the subject of many YouTube videos, some good, some not so good. But it did happen, and it was really huge, airbursting and flattening 2,000 square kilometers of the Russian Taiga. Had this happened over a populated area, the devastation and loss of life would have been unimaginable. The explosion's estimates in terms of tons of TNT, or how we calculate nuclear weapons yields, varies wildly from 3 to 30 megatons. This was a meteoroid, not a nuclear weapon, so there's a lot of debate there. But in terms of scale, no matter what, it was many, many times greater than the atomic bombs of World War II, though actually smaller than some of the hydrogen bomb tests of the Cold War era. Despite its size, though, little material was found remaining of the Tunguska object. There was no meteorite strewn field as you have with craters like Beringer Crater in Arizona or Australia's Henbury Crater. There have been, among the 1,000 scientific papers written about Tunguska, reports of finding material that might be solidified vapor from the object. It's long been pointed out by scientists that this would be consistent with material from a comet entering the atmosphere rather than an asteroid fragment. Asteroid material can be rather dense, such as nickel-iron meteorites show. Comet material, however, is loose and icy, which means it does not last long passing through an atmosphere like Earth's, and is likely to vaporize and leave very little behind. But a fragment of a comet is still an object, so lots of energy would be released when it fell, as what happened at Tunguska. Today, a Tunguska-like event over populated land on Earth would be far worse in effect. How much of a threat the Taurid streams pose to Earth is still an open question, and comparatively little work has been done on the subject in recent years, or at least I couldn't find it if there is ongoing work. If anyone knows of anything, do let me know. But for now, we probably should be on the lookout when it comes to the Taurid meteor streams. Thanks for listening. I am science fiction author and futurist John Michael Godier, currently with an imminent book release. Supermind is coming soon, and be sure to check out my other books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channel for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.